Now That You're Gone by Julie Corbin. Prologue. Every night since your death, I've dreamt the same dream. We're 10 years old and we're cycling along the track that leads to our house, yellow flowering rapeseed head high in the fields either side of us. I'm pedalling as fast as I can, my face redder than a raspberry. You're at least a wheel's length in front, sometimes more, but never less. For years, I believe I can win, but I never do, and you never let me. When we get home, we throw ourselves onto the rug in front of the TV and watch the Saturday afternoon film, sucking on sherbet dabs and sticks of licorice. I wish I could wake up then, but I don't. The dream jumps time, fast forwards to the morgue. I'm in a lift. A woman stands beside me. We have plastic name badges on cord loops around our necks. The lift doors open and we walk along a corridor. That's when my heart starts to race, because there's a part of me that knows I'm dreaming and that I have to wake myself up. Now. Right now. We go into a room. About 5 metres away, there is a metal trolley. A body-shaped mound covered with a sheet lies on top. Adrenaline surges through me, demanding that I run! I try to lift my feet, but they're stuck to the floor. I try to turn my head, but my neck feels as if it's encased in cement. The trolley starts to slide towards me, and as it slides, the sheet slips away from the face. At first the trolley's pace is slow, and then it moves more quickly until it bangs up against my thighs. Don't look. Don't look. Don't look. I look. It's you, Dougie. Your battered, bruised, part blue, part waxen flesh frames lifeless, empty eyes that stare up at me. I scream myself awake, and into another day without you. 1. It can't be you. The exact moment your body was being pulled from the Clyde, I was driving to work. I was singing along to the radio, badly. You know me, I wouldn't win any prizes for my voice, but when the 80s tunes get going, so do I. The sun was well above the horizon, and Edinburgh was in the distance, looking grand like she always does. I made it to work before the rain started, and 2 hours into the morning I had a second mug of coffee by my hand and was assessing an insurance claim. The policyholder had made 3 substantial claims in as many years, and I was about to dig deeper into his story when Alec came into the room.
Isla.
He cleared his throat.
You need to come into my office.
Can I finish this first?
No. Come now.
His fingers tumbled through the change in his pockets.
Don't ask me why, love, just come through.
My smile faltered because, well, you know Alec. He has difficulty with eye contact, never mind terms of endearment, and he had never called me love, not even when Gavin had just left me and he found me crying in the loo. All I'd warranted then was a vague,
never mind, and you're better off without him.
And he left me to quietly mourn the end of my marriage. What's wrong? I said.
The police.
He trailed off, throwing an arm out behind him.
In my office.
Why? I stood up slowly. Jesus, it's not one of my kids, is it? Breathing was suddenly difficult. I shut my eyes and immediately felt dizzy, so I opened them again. Please tell me it's not one of my kids.
No, love. It's not one of your kids.
He took hold of my elbow and I walked alongside him into his office. I didn't think of you at that point, Dougie. Family names and faces pushed to the front of my mind. Dad, Gavin, Marie, Danny, Jess, Martha, Eric. But not yours. You could always take care of yourself. You'd spent 20 years in the Royal Marines. You had combat skills, and you had the reflexes of a man half your age. You were the last person I ever worried about. Two police officers were standing by the window. The younger one had a sharp haircut and a bodybuilder's frame. The other one was lithe and balding. They introduced themselves, but I didn't hear their names or their ranks, because when I saw the serious expressions on their faces, my ears filled with a high-pitched ringing sound.
"What happened?" I said too loudly. "Is it Gavin?"
"Are you Isla McTeer?" the younger one asked. I nodded. "Would you like to take a seat, Isla?"
"Just tell me."
"Isla," Alex said, "why don't you sit down?"
"I don't want to."
I kept my eyes on the officers.
"Please just tell me what's happened."
"Have you been in contact with your brother recently?" the younger one said.
"Yesterday."
I shook my head at him.
"Why?"
"We are sorry to inform you." He stopped talking and glanced at the older man, whose face was unreadable.
"We are sorry to inform you that the police in Glasgow have found a body."
His Adam's apple moved through a slow and deliberate swallow.
"We think it might be your brother."
A silent scream tunnelled through my chest, but I held it there, tightly. There was no letting it escape, because Dougie, how could it be you? I'd have known. I'd have felt something. You are my twin, for God's sake. We might not have been kids anymore, but we were still closer than most siblings.
No. No. Can't be. Can't be my brother. He's in good health. He's well.
I nodded my head. He's really healthy.
"We understand that this is a shock for you," the older man said.
I met his eyes and immediately flinched away from the sympathy in them. I stared across at Alec, hoping for him to voice loud denial.
"Dougie, not a chance. There's the door. Fuck off and bother someone else."
But Alec said nothing. He was standing by the window, his head bowed, his hands joined in front of his stomach. His sorrow was palpable, and it ignited a panic inside me. I held onto the corner of the desk to steady myself. The ringing in my ears had stopped, but my heart had expanded to fill my ribcage and was beating fast enough to make me gasp. This morning, at 7:30, a barge operator noticed a body in the Clyde, the younger officer said. When the body was pulled out of the water, there was a wallet with photo ID and a mobile phone in the jacket pocket. He cleared his throat. Both items belong to your brother.
No. No, no, no.
I gulped a couple of shallow breaths and clenched my fists by my sides.
That can't be right.
The younger policeman took a step away from me, while the older one moved forward and steered me into Alec's chair. I focused on the desk, on the familiar. Photos of Alec's grandchildren, messy piles of papers, pens and clips and drawing pins, a rubber band ball. I picked up the ball and gripped it in my hand.
"He needs to be formally identified, but the evidence would suggest that the man is your brother,"
the older one said. My mind clutched blindly for a reply, but I couldn't find any words to counter what he'd said. I squeezed the ball tighter.
"You don't have to do this on your own, Isla."
The older policeman was kneeling down in front of me now.
"Is there someone you would like to accompany you?"
I closed my eyes then. I closed them because I wanted the men to stop talking so that I could think. We were 12 on holiday in Skye.
"Come on, Isla,"
you shouted. I stayed on the bank and watched you dive into the freezing water, swim all the way out to the buoy and back again. 100 metres or more. My heart was in my mouth.
"Mum will be mad," I shouted after you. "It's dangerous."
Still, you swam.
"It won't be Dougie."
I opened my eyes and stared the policeman down. He's an ex-marine and a strong swimmer. He couldn't possibly have drowned.
The older policeman pursed his lips and put a hand on my arm. I could tell what he was thinking. I was in denial. And he was right. I was. I was in so much denial that my whole body hummed with enough energy to send me off on a 100-mile run, non-stop, taking me far, far away from a possible future that didn't include you. It won't be Dougie, I repeated. I stood up and faced the three doubting men. We can go to Glasgow if you like, but it won't be him. If you'd met my brother, you'd know that he's just... He wouldn't drown. I shrugged my shoulders. He just wouldn't. I left the room to fetch my bag and my coat. But before I rejoined Alec and the policeman, I locked myself in the loo and called your mobile. Just pick up, Dougie. Pick up. I willed your voice on the other end of the line, but there was no answer. And then I remembered that the policeman had said your mobile was in the dead man's pocket. I was momentarily deflated, felt myself begin to plummet back down into a quicksand of panic. You weren't one for losing your things, and you were too canny to have anything pinched. But there could always be a first time. Of course there could. You weren't infallible. Just because the police had your phone and your wallet, that didn't mean that the dead body was you. And when I got to Glasgow, I would see that that was true. Some other poor sister had lost her brother, not me. Before I left the bathroom, I called your landline, twice. And twice it went through to your answering machine.
This is Douglas McTeer, private investigator. Please leave a message and I'll get back to you as soon as I can.
Dougie? It's me, I said the first time. Call me as soon as you get this. There's been a terrible mix-up. I need to know you're okay. Please call me. And the second time. Dougie, it's me. For fuck's sake, what's going on? Call me. Call me now.
All the way to the morgue, I had myself convinced that it wouldn't be you. I sat in the back of the police car and the two policemen sat in the front, wipers full on, clearing raindrops the size of elephants' tears from the windscreen. For most of the journey, I kept my eyes closed, visualising you walking, talking, laughing, and full of life, as if my thoughts alone could keep you alive. We arrived at the morgue just as office workers were braving the weather to buy some lunch. Umbrellas were blowing inside out, and coats were being held close to bodies shrinking inwards against the rain. We parked at the entrance and went inside a drab grey building lodged between two red brick Victorian ones. My two escorts left me there, and someone else, a woman this time, had me sign myself in at reception. She introduced herself, but I didn't register either her name or her job title. She hung a temporary identification badge around my neck and asked me to come with her. We walked along a corridor, the cold stone floor amplifying the sound of our footsteps so that the noise echoed up past the grimy, opaque windows to the ceiling. The walls were decorated to shoulder height with bottle green tiles that must have once been shiny and new, but were now dull and chipped, the grouting between them grey and tired. We stopped in front of a lift, and the woman pressed the button. "Would you like us to call a family member or a friend?" she asked me, her tone solicitous. "You don't have to do this on your own." "No." I'd already turned down Alec's offer to accompany me, and Richie was in Florida with his daughter, Leonie. "I'll be fine." Her face was all sympathy and doubt. "I will," I said. "Chances are it isn't my brother." The lift took us down to the basement, and we walked a few paces into a sparsely furnished room containing just four chairs and a coffee table, a water cooler, and a pile of plastic cups. There was a window almost filling one whole wall from waist height up to the ceiling. I looked through the glass and into another room, where a man in blue scrubs and white clogs stood next to a long table. And on the table, there was a body-shaped bulge lying beneath a sheet.
We think the body was in the water for at least 12 hours, the woman told me. There are some injuries to the face and neck, most likely where he made contact with a boat or the banks of the river. She paused, and I managed a jerky nod of my head to show her I could hear what she was saying. And I could hear what she was saying, but I wasn't listening. I was praying with all my might, making frantic promises to God. I'd never be mean again. I'd give money to charity. Even better, I'd work for a charity. I'd join the church, and I'd never complain. Ever again. Just please, 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 don't let me see my brother lying under the sheet. The woman kept talking. The skin colour would be mottled. He was dressed in a white gown. I'm ready, I see, interrupting her. I was beginning to imagine a strange smell in the room. Decay, blood and chemicals mixed together in an unpleasant cocktail that made me want to vomit. The woman nodded to the man on the other side of the glass, and he lifted the sheet away from the face. He didn't roll it back onto the chest, but held it up in the air in an attempt to screen the right side of the head and body. The shielding didn't work. I was able to see what he was trying to hide. The man's ear was torn, the side of his face bruised, a 4-inch gash on his neck. It took about 5 seconds for me to register that this bloated and battered corpse belonged to my brother. To you, Dougie. It was you. Is this the body of your brother, Douglas McTeer? The woman asked. I nodded, then swayed to one side. The woman caught hold of my shoulders and directed me into one of the chairs. Over the next hour, I alternated between numbness and sorrow, both intense and disabling, a prelude to the road ahead. The woman took me back upstairs to an administrative office, where there was a blur of people and information, but I couldn't retain any of it. Faces, words or instructions. 1 second I was coping, my eyes were open, I could see to read, I could hold a pen, I was nodding and answering as if following what was being said to me. The next second, I felt as if I'd been punched hard in the stomach, winded, unable to breathe, curling my spine forward until I was hunched on the chair. The woman sat down beside me. She gave me a hot mug of tea that grew cold in my hands. I could hear her words of comfort but was unable to respond until finally one clear thought emerged. I have to tell my dad, I said. He lives in Dundee. Okay, she nodded. And do you have any other family members? My mum's dead. My sister lives in Norway. Was your brother married? Divorced, I said, from Tanya, who still professed to love you, despite the trouble she'd caused. Did your brother have any children? No. Do you have a partner who can come to the station and collect you? I thought again about Richie. I have a friend, but he went to Florida yesterday. My ex-husband will come, though. He's a policeman. What's his name? Gavin Coates. He's an inspector. He's stationed at the headquarters in Edinburgh, but I know he's in Glasgow today. Pitt Street, I think. She smiled her relief, grateful that at last I had given her something to go on. I watched as she made a phone call, and then an image flashed before my eyes. Your battered body lying on a metal table, lifeless as an Arctic winter, and a top-to-toe shiver robbed me of breath. I waited until I could breathe again, kept my head up and focused my attention on the poster on the wall in front of me. A health and safety directive, detailing emergency exits and assembly points. I was determined not to think about your last moments, how you might have suffered, struggled, called for help, how you could have fallen into the water in the first place, and force myself to think instead about when I'd last seen you, only 3 days previously, when you'd come to take Finlay to the football. "Come on, Finn," I shouted up the stairs. "Uncle Dougie's waiting."
"I'll take him for something to eat afterwards," you said.
Caitlin's staying over at Gavin's, so I thought I'd go and see Richie.
"Love in the afternoon."
You nudged my shoulder.
"All right for some."
I laughed and pushed you away, and you fell against a door jamb, clutched your arm, feigning an injury. You were your usual cheery self, looking forward to spending time with your nephew. There was no mention of a trip to Glasgow. We talked about work, and you told me you were still busy running surveillance for Alec, gathering evidence for the Prendergast insurance fraud, all of it based in Edinburgh. Finn came clattering down the stairs.
"Got your singing voice ready?"
you asked.
"Yeah,"
he grinned up at you.
"Come on, the high bees."
You laughed and put an arm around his shoulder.
"Say goodbye to your mum, then."
"Bye, Mum. Be good now."
"We will,"
you said. You were halfway through the door, and then you turned back and smiled at me.
"Don't do anything I wouldn't do," you said.
Finn and Caitlin were going to be devastated. You were such a large part of their lives. Not having kids yourself had worked in their favour. I didn't know how I was going to break the news of your death to them. The very thought made me want to fall to the ground and weep. "Your ex-husband's on his way over." The woman was back beside me. "He'll only be about 20 minutes.
"That's great."
I aimed for a smile, but my facial muscles were frozen.
"Thank you."
"Can I get you another tea?"
"No, thanks."
"Something to eat?"
"No."
She moved away from me, and I drifted off into memories. You as a child, larger than life and twice as much trouble.
You couldn't sit still. You were always up to something.
We'd been great friends, me and you, hadn't we? Because Mum was usually busy with Marie, and we were expected to just get on with it. Long school holidays we played together, loading up our rucksacks and setting off on journeys on our bikes. We didn't go far, but we felt like we were intrepid. I always carried the food and the map, you carried the compass and our drinks. We would lie on the hills and watch cars go by, recording the license plates into old school jotters, as if the letters and numbers might one day prove to be significant. Of course, you weren't always nice to me. You gave me Chinese burns, twisting the skin on my wrist around in both directions, until I let you have what you wanted. I had to set the table for you, or lend you my pocket money, or lie to Mum and Dad about what you'd been up to after school.
"Isla?"
I glanced up, clocked Gavin's face for a split second before he lifted me off the chair and into his chest, my cheek pressed up against his jacket, which was wet with rain. We hadn't hugged for years, and it felt too strange to be comforting. I tried to pull away, but he held me tighter.
"Jesus, Isla. Jesus. This is terrible. So terrible."
He let out a frustrated sigh.
"Why didn't you call me? I could have identified his body for you."
"Because I was sure it wouldn't be him." I pulled away again, successfully this time, and stared into Gavin's face. "Because how could he have drowned? You know what a good swimmer he was. He's only just swum a mile for cancer research. He was fit and healthy and..." I threw out my arms. "Why was he even in Glasgow?"
"There'll be an investigation, Isla."
He took hold of both my hands.
"But for now, we need to tell your dad and Marie."
"And the kids?"
"And the kids."
I began to tremble, the enormity of what lay ahead flooding me with fear. I wasn't about to wake up. I couldn't pretend that this was all a mistake, slip back to the office and continue with work as if nothing had happened. I had lost you, Dougie. For good. forever. And now I was going to have to break the news to the people who loved you the most, and the thought of having to do this proved to be my tipping point. I cried then. Tears erupted through me, wave after wave, rising from my feet, gathering strength in my middle, and pouring onto my cheeks in an abandonment of hope.
Isla. Gavin was hugging me again. It's going to be okay.
Okay. Sorrow ricocheted inside me, making my chest heave. How, Gavin? How?
2. This is my now. The next couple of weeks passed slowly, my emotions swooping and plummeting on a second-by-second basis. My head and my heart were full of missing you, Dougie. I was angry and desolate, but mostly I felt a heart-thumping, dry-mouthed anxiety. Grief feels like fear, Colette told me. I remember that from when my dad died. As you would have expected, Colette was rallying round. Gavin came over every day to give us an update on the police investigation, and mostly Colette came too. She brought homeopathic remedies and regular sleeping pills, chamomile tea and lavender-scented candles, boxes of tissues and bottles of wine. I could have easily thrown most of it back at her, but she shopped and she cooked and she cleaned up after us. She did all the things I had no energy for, and so even though she was the woman who had stolen my husband, I was grateful for her help. I spent all of my time with Dad and the kids, and while Dad and Finn were mostly quiet, Caitlin stomped around slamming doors, then bursting into sustained bouts of crying that left her exhausted. I spent hours sitting in her bed, stroking her hair while she talked through her pain. It hurt so much to watch her, I can't tell you. Dad came straight down from Dundee as soon as he heard the news. Gavin collected him from the station, and when I opened the door to them, Dad fell against me, holding me as if he never wanted to let me go. I found it hard to look him in the eye, because his expression mirrored my own, both bleak and questioning, the how and the why of your death as yet unknown to us. He spent his time sitting in the corner of the living room on the armchair that belonged to Gavin, or walking Myrtle up and down the hills, taking Finn with him. I watched the pair of them crossing the field at the back of the house, Myrtle chasing around at their feet. Dad's arm was on Finn's shoulder, and they leant into each other, holding one another up. In those early days, it was only Richie who brought me comfort. Just 6 weeks into our relationship, and I hadn't expected much from him. But when he called me that first evening, the sound of his voice gave my heart the tiniest of lifts.
We're standing in a queue at Universal Studios, he said. How are things back in Scotland?
My brother died, I blurted out.
What? What?
He drowned.
Isla, Isla, sweetheart, this is...
He took a breath.
Listen, I'll come home early. I can easily change our flights.
No, no, that's not fair on Leonie. She's been looking forward to our holiday with you. I closed my eyes and leant up against the doorframe. Just talking to you is enough. He spoke to me for an hour every day. Or mostly I spoke and he listened. He made me feel as if I wasn't sinking, that I wasn't going mad, and that, while life without you felt impossible, I would find a way through. I would. And he would help me.
You knew about Richie,
but I hadn't yet mentioned him to the rest of the family, so I took the calls in my bedroom, always after midnight when everyone was asleep. You thought there was no need for me to keep him a secret, but after the false start a year after Gavin left, my internet dating disaster, I'd made the decision that I wouldn't introduce a boyfriend to the kids unless I was sure he'd be around for a while. Richie was the first man I'd been out with in 3 whole years. We were just at the point when I was ready to have him meet the family. And then you died. I wish I'd the chance to introduce him to you, Dougie. You would have liked each other. I'm sure of it. 3 days after your death, Gavin came round with the pathologist's report. Caitlin and Finn were in bed, and Colette was working late. Marie had yet to fly over from Norway because Eric was on the rigs, and there was no one to look after the kids. So it was just Dad and me, sitting side by side at the dining table. Gavin passed me the report, but I couldn't read any further than your name at the top of the page. My eyes filled with tears, and I held it out to Dad, but he shook his head and shied away from it. "You'll have to tell us what it says," I told Gavin.
"This is just the initial report. The full report will be with us early next week, and then the Procurator Fiscal will make a decision as to the cause of death."
He cleared his throat.
"As you know, Dougie's body was taken out of the water close to the Glasgow Science Centre. The marine unit gathered water samples, caught debris and detritus, anything that might help build a picture of how he came to be in the water."
"And?"
Dad's voice was gruff with grief and impatience.
"Nothing of any note," Gavin said. "The toxicology report, however, suggests that Dougie had been drinking."
"Drinking what? Drinking how much?"
Dad asked.
"Enough to affect his reflexes," Gavin said. "There are no lights on that part of the riverbank. It would be easy for someone who was unfamiliar with the area and had been drinking to miss their footing and fall in."
"But isn't it all lit up around the science centre?" I said.
"He didn't fall in there, Isla," Gavin said.
"How do you know that?"
"Because of the damage caused to his body and the debris that was caught in his clothing. He'd clearly been swept downstream."
"I need a whiskey."
Dad stood up and took a bottle and a glass tumbler from the cabinet.
"I can't listen to this sober, Isla. I'm sorry."
He sat back down again and half filled the glass.
"I just can't."
I reached for his free hand and held it. "Was there water in Dougie's lungs?"
"Yes," Gavin said. "He was alive when he entered the river."
I imagine what that would have felt like. Fighting for air, trying to resist the weight of water, holding out against the pull of the tide, and my own breathing stalled. I had several seconds when I couldn't catch my breath, and then I started coughing. Dad thumped me on the back, and Gavin went through to the kitchen to fetch me some water. I drank a couple of sips and then nodded to Gavin to continue.
"Tidal flow allows us to estimate where his body entered the water," he said. "In Dougie's case, about half a mile upstream from the science centre. Local police have been around the bars and clubs in the area and have discovered he was drinking in a pub called the Lone Star. Several of the regulars said he left the pub alone that night. There was no sign of a scuffle on the riverbank, no reason to suspect anything other than an accident."
"That's a relief of sorts," Dad said. "I was worried about foul play."
He nodded into his whiskey.
"Small mercies."
Neither of us had articulated that particular worry, but it had been at the back of my mind too. Crouching there, waiting to rip out what was left of our hearts. You'd been gathering evidence for the case against Ivan Prendergast, and Prendergast was nothing if not a crook. I had been afraid that you might have been targeted by hired thugs, so like Dad said, we were grateful for small mercies.
"He fell in the water because he was drunk?"
Dad asked.
"Yes," Gavin said.
My thoughts switched direction and a fist of anger punched inside me. I stood up and slammed my hand on the table.
"Isla!"
Dad's voice was quiet.
"Sit yourself down."
"He died because he was drunk? That's it? Drunk?"
"Isla."
"I've lost my brother because he was drunk and careless and fell in the bloody Clyde."
"Shh," Gavin said. "You'll wake the kids."
"Why would he have done that? Why?" I walked away from the table and paced up and down in front of the television. Why was he even there, for God's sake? It doesn't make sense.
The barman remembers him speaking to people in passing, but no one sat down with him for any length of time, Gavin said.
Perhaps he was stood up, Dad said.
Maybe by a friend or an ex-marine like himself, Gavin said. That would explain why he didn't take his van with him. He must have known he was going to have a drink.
So where is this friend? I shouted. Where is this marine?
I understand why you're angry, Gavin said.
You know what, Gavin? I snapped. You understand fuck all.
Have it your way.
Gavin gave me a hard stare and stood up.
I'll leave you both to it.
You do that. I turned my back on him, rage peaking inside me, making my whole body pulse with pent-up aggression. I wanted to smash up the room, tear down the curtains, pull pictures off the walls, upend all the furniture. But mostly, I wanted to take you by the shoulders and shake you. Shake you until your teeth rattled and your jaw dislocated. Because how could you be so stupid, Dougie? How? When I heard the front door close, I turned back into the room. We still don't know why he was in Glasgow, Dad. I want to speak to the person he was supposed to meet.
Isla. Dad's expression was fatigued. I know how you feel, but anger isn't the answer.
So we just accept it, Dad. Is that it? He gave a weary sigh, and I watched a single tear slide down his cheek as he poured himself another whiskey. The full report came through a week later. The Procurator Fiscal had considered all the facts and delivered a verdict of accidental death. You'd been drinking alone. You left the pub. The riverbank was dark. You fell in the water. Case closed. Your body was released for burial. Okay, so you liked a drink. I accepted that. But why Glasgow? Why that particular pub? Who were you meeting? And why didn't you tell me about it? I'd seen you just 3 days before you died, and you never said a word. It could have been last minute, but still, you'd normally text me. We didn't live in one another's pockets, but we did tend to keep each other informed of our whereabouts. I couldn't get my head around the sheer unlikeliness of it all, but for the next few days, I put my concerns to one side because I needed to arrange your funeral. I paid for an announcement in the evening news. I ordered flowers and cars and a function room for afterwards. I did it all as best I could, but truthfully, I didn't do you justice. I know we'd always joked about going out in style, but that was because we'd imagined we'd both be in our 80s, and death would be a timely end to a life well lived, an escape from the cruelty of an unhealthy, lingering old age. You were 42. My twin. It wasn't supposed to be like this. Marie flew over from Norway, looking thin and tired, but then she had 3 children under 5 and now her brother was dead, so it was hardly surprising. She reminded me so much of Mum, with her white blonde hair and pale blue eyes, cold and piercing when she was angry. But now they were full of tears. The taxi dropped her off at the house just minutes before the cars arrived to take us to your funeral. We stood in the doorway hugging, Dad too, and then we climbed into the cars. The crematorium was full of your friends, Dougie. People I knew and people I didn't, and it made me proud to see how popular you'd been. Proud and sad. My feelings rollercoasting up and down on an endless loop of hope and despair. Marie and I walked down the aisle on either side of Dad, holding him under his arms. He seemed to have lost the strength in his legs and kept tipping forward as if he wanted the floor to swallow him up. We sat down in the front row, the wooden benches hard and unforgiving. Along the pew from us, Gavin had his arms around Caitlin and Finn. Caitlin was crying into her hands. Finn's chin dipped down into the Hibs football scarf you'd bought for him.
his eyes locked on his shiny black shoes that had been rigorously polished by Colette. I wanted to be with them both, but Dad needed me beside him. His grief came from fathom deep in his chest and set off a spasm of coughing that doubled him up even more. Marie kept staring at me over his head, her expression an unspoken question mark of worry. We just lost Dougie. We weren't about to lose Dad as well, were we? The last funeral we'd been to was Mum's. Marie was heavily pregnant and had sat with Eric, you and I on either side of Dad that time. Mum's death had been swift and cruel, from diagnosis to death in no time. 2 weeks in hospital and already the cancer had stolen her vitality. Her skin was grey and lines were deepening across her forehead and cheeks. There was no treatment for what she had, and we were all slowly coming around to the fact that we would lose her. "Now listen, you two." She held her hands as we sat on the edge of her bed. "Dad and Marie will take my death hard."
"Mum, I..." "Isla."
She silenced me with a steady look.
"I know what you're going to say, but you and Dougie have each other. But, and that makes it easier for you."
I sighed. "Just let me see it. Please." She glanced at you and you both smiled. I felt the briefest tug of jealousy, and then she looked back at me and said,
"Go on then, Isla. Tell me."
"Thank you. Thank you for being the best mother a girl could ever have. I'm going to..."
I took a big breath.
"I'm going to miss you every day."
My vision blurred.
"Forever."
She took my hand onto her knee and stroked my hair. It was only a matter of seconds before she swapped her hand for yours. After your funeral, we all gathered in the Swanston Inn, over 100 of us, eating and drinking and trying to make merry, just as you would have wanted us to. I couldn't pull it off, though. Despair swirled around inside me like a persistent coastal fog, rendering me cold and blind to enjoyment. Lamps, Crofty and Egg were there, along with several other men from your unit. I knew that as Marines, you'd go to the ends of the earth for one another, and I found myself asking the same questions of each of them. When had they last spoken to you? Had they heard of the Lone Star pub? Did they know why you were in Glasgow that evening? None of them knew anything. They sat with Dad and Uncle Tam, reminiscing big time. I was pleased to see Dad smile, but I found it impossible to join in. They were celebrating you, Dougie, your achievements, your life, and they were right to do so. But I just couldn't find a way to be part of it. Marie had booked herself a taxi to the airport, but I told her I would drive her. I wouldn't see her again for a while, and I wanted to spend more time in her company. "I hope you know I'd stay with you and Dad longer if I could," she said, "but I can't leave the kids for more than a day." "I understand." We were holding hands awkwardly across the table in the airport cafe. I don't need to tell you that Marie and I have never been close, but I really wanted to try to move beyond the friction. It wasn't only the obvious stuff. She liked rom-coms, I liked thrillers. She can shop for hours, I like to get in and out as quickly as possible. It was more than the sum of all of that. I've always found Marie attention-seeking. She had more of Mum and Dad's time than you and me put together. She was always the one who had to be considered. She played on the fact that we were twins and Mum and Dad fell for it. She was the cute one, still the baby even when she was 30. Even when Mum was dying, Marie got the best of her. "Get over it," you told me. And I tried. I'm still trying. "It's okay, Marie," I said. "You need to get back home. They'll all be missing you. Eric couldn't get time off the rigs, and the kids are too much for his mother to handle. Especially Martha. She's at that age,
talking all the time, into everything. It's fine, Marie. Really, it is. Poor Dad. He's so sad. Losing Dougie. And that cough. You need to get him to the doctor.
I will.
And then he can stay with me for a bit. He doesn't need to go back to Dundee until he's ready. He should move back to Edinburgh to be nearer you. I'll see if I can persuade him. I just can't believe it. I really can't believe it. She wrestled a tissue out of her pocket. Dougie. Her eyes were brimming with tears. He's gone, Isla. How can he be? How can he be gone? Our brother drowned. I don't get it. I really don't get it. She rocked back and forth, sobbing into an already soggy tissue. I went to her side of the table to put my arms around her, and she clung to me like a child, her speech growing increasingly incoherent.
Because of... It wasn't even... I haven't taken...
I wanted to cry too, but I was measuring out my tears into small, 10-second bouts of weeping that merely skimmed the surface of a reservoir of grief, because I was afraid that when I gave in, I would break down completely. Then I'd be no use to anyone. And I was still angry with you, so fucking angry, because you'd been careless and you'd left us, and our family was lost without you. I'm not easygoing. I don't have your compassion or your patience. You were the fixer and the comforter, and I am a poor substitute. But still, I kept my arms around Marie until she'd sobbed herself empty.
Did you see Tanya at the funeral? She asked, when I had finally sat down again.
I did, but I didn't speak to her.
Crying like she actually cared.
Bitch. I never liked her.
She blew her nose. Mum didn't like her either. And she was a good judge of character.
She was. And not just about Tanya.
Bringing a stranger with her? I mean, who was that guy?
I don't know. Tanya introduced him to me, but his name went in one ear and out the other.
Had he even met our brother? Did he even care?
Anger was drying her tears.
Bloody cheek!
She blew her nose again, then rammed the tissue into her jacket pocket.
God knows what Dougie ever saw in her.
Love has its reasons. You told me what you saw in Tanya. Do you remember? She was funny and smart, you said. She was a survivor. She could turn any situation to her advantage. You admired that about her. And then there was the sex.
Epic, you said.
Marie sighed and drank the last of her coffee.
Are you going to manage to sort through his stuff on your own?
Yeah.
Don't rush.
Her lips trembled.
It'll be hard.
I'll manage. I conjured up a reassuring smile. I'll make sure to get the house in the market as soon as I can. Even as I said it, I knew I didn't mean it.
Sell your house?
Never. You loved it too much.
What do you think, Isla?
You said, widening your arms to include the damp, dilapidated apology of a house and the acre of land encircling it.
It's got potential right enough, I said.
It'll be a lot of work, though.
I can do most of it myself.
You smiled at me.
Give me a couple of years. This place will be a palace.
We better get you to the gate, Marie. I stood up. Don't want you missing your plane.
You need to look after yourself, Isla.
She hugged me as we walked, her head resting on my shoulder.
And keep me updated about Dad.
I will. I stood at the departure gate and watched her as she took her place in the moving queue. Every time she turned around to seek me out, I waved, and she waved back. When she was out of sight, I went back to my car and sat in the driving seat with my eyes shut. Mum had been on my mind a lot since your death, and while I was glad she wasn't here to suffer your loss, I needed her. I needed her common sense and her steady eye.
Are you really sure about Gavin, Isla?
Mum asked. We were in the back garden. I'd come home from town where Gavin and I had been window shopping for an engagement ring. You were training in the Far East, and it was 2 months since we'd properly spoken. What do you mean? I replied. Mum put down the secateurs.
I'm saying this because I care.
I braced myself, but I listened, because when Mum spoke, we did listen, didn't we?
Sometimes Gavin seems superficial.
Dougie likes him.
Does he?
He introduced us.
Isla.
She took my hands in hers. Her nails were dirty, but it made no difference. She had that Nordic elegance that can't be faked, can't be bought. The way she held herself, the tone of her voice, her quiet confidence.
Be careful. He's the sort of man who needs to be put first, and that is incompatible with raising children.
It was years before I understood what she meant. The next day, Dad went to Uncle Tam's. Bronte's litter of puppies was 5 weeks old, so Caitlin and Finn went too, while I kept an appointment with Mr. Piddy. We were both executors of your will, and as your solicitor, Mr. Piddy took charge. There were no surprises. Everything was to be divided between myself, Dad and Marie.
Your brother's house is one story, with 3 bedrooms,
Mr. Piddy said to me, regarding me above the line of his reading glasses. He had planning permission to expand into the roof space, but he hadn't got round to it.
Yes, indeed. And there is an office built onto the site?
There is.
And will you want to put the house on the market immediately?
No, I said. Not straight away. We agreed that I would check through your mail, see whether there were any bills or work in progress that needed immediate attention. I left Mr. Perry's office and drove to your house, my hands gripping the steering wheel. Part of me was afraid that when I went inside your home and sorted through your papers, grief would close in on me, drag me under and hold me there, like a crocodile with an antelope. But there was another part of me that needed to be close to you. You'd been dead for 2 weeks. 2 whole weeks since I'd heard your voice. And how long was it since that happened? By my reckoning, almost 4 years, soon after Gavin left me, and 10 months before Mum died. We had 20 years of living in different parts of the country, the frequency of our get-togethers dependent on where you were stationed, but we still managed birthdays and Christmases, and plenty of days in between. And then when you left the Marines, we were both separated, and we ended up living as neighbours. You set yourself up as a private investigator, and Alec offered you work. It was perfect, Dougie. I saw you most days. The kids loved you. You were just along the road. If only it could have stayed that way. I turned off the main road and down the track, my car bouncing its way over the ruts and potholes before I reached your cottage.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.